So here we are, and again, we're going to skip my little introduction, but I do want to take a moment and just make a plug for our online community. All right, so today we're going to be covering spectrum of processed foods, toxins, and moving towards things made with better ingredients. I already had a really good question from Jared and his daughter from the talk yesterday that I want to address. We won't go into too much detail about real food because we just covered this yesterday, but we will talk a little bit about this concept, nutritional vitality, and then we'll go through the produce department, the meat department, the dairy and eggs, and then answer any questions that you guys have. So remember, what we're doing together as a freaking community is we are bringing together people who for most of their lives have been lost and confused when it comes to health, and now they're seeking clarity and confidence. To learn these health concepts together, to put those concepts into practice through experience and experimentation, and to support each other through the process so that we can bring confidence and clarity to those seeking truth through education, experience, and support. And we're doing this, remember, because we want to be happy, healthy, confident in our bodies, confident in what we're doing so that we can live our most amazing life possible and rediscover how we're meant to live. If you're not a part of our freaking online community, Superhumans United, you need to be a part of it. Every month we have a monthly theme. The first 2 months of this year obviously are focused on the masterclass in nutrition, but after that we get into all kinds of cool stuff throughout the year. Usually we'll have a weekly seminar, sometimes a bi-weekly seminar that always gets recorded and put into the community. We have really cool little questions and polls that usually come up once or twice a week that get us talking to each other. And again, we're here to clarify the confusion and bring confidence to all our people. And I just want to make a plug for just brutally simple in general. I don't know when I came up with that term. I feel like I invented a lot of the modern English, like pro tip. I think I embedded that. And now I see it being used at Home Depot and Lowe's and like online, all kinds of places. Like everybody's eavesdropping on me. But anyway, brutally simple. Like I'm just picturing a lot of times people come into this and they just don't know anything. They don't know how to cook. They don't know what to buy. And so in my mind, I'm just trying to keep things as simple as possible, which means questioning the status quo on ingredients, on how to cook. And that's what we want. We want things that are super, super simple and not ultra complicated. I can't stand recipes that require a million different steps and a lot of very precise ingredients. We try to keep things really simple. Arnica and I, most evenings when we come home and cook dinner, like it's we have a plan in our mind, but we still cook it every night. And we come home and it's simple seasonings, very quick. Within 10 or 15 minutes, we've got a dinner, no problem. Now, some helpful handouts to have available would be your guide and then the shopping list. If you picked one of those up or there's a PDF version, you don't have to necessarily reference it today, but like some of these things might be in there. And then our food quality ingredients and shopping notes, that was also the handouts out here. Those are also downloadable inside the community. Not crucial, but might be helpful, okay? All right. So, by the way, Arnica, if like something goes wrong with my audio or something, I have my text messages pulled up. No, there's no mute. Okay, so Arnica asks, your voice can't be heard unless I bring you up on screen. So Crowdcast is designed for like these presentation type situations versus Zoom where we like all are having conversations. So, but if you can just let me know if my audio goes out or something like that. All right, so, you know, we've already talked about like one of the things that we're trying to do as we become real foodies and as we're on this path to trying to optimize our real food nutrition is just trying to make choices for products that are made with better ingredients. So it's like for just about everything that you think you're gonna have to give up, there's probably an alternative for it. So I put together this processed food spectrum, okay? On the far left, we have ultra processed food, which is also standard American diet type stuff, right? So this is stuff that's made with completely wrong ingredients and highly, highly processed. So we have things, you know, like the donuts and the cereals and the cookies and all that stuff. It's very high in calories, very high in sugar, usually, or starch, high in toxins because of all the different preservatives and toxic oils and things that we already know that we need to avoid. And it has little to no nutrients that the body can use. So we're trying to stay out of that for sure, 100%. Then we can, what we want to do is move into this world where if I'm going to have some chips, if I'm going to have a cereal, if I'm going to have something that otherwise might be off limits, I at least want to choose better ingredients. And so this would be processed foods made with better ingredients. All right. This is what we call SHT approved items. All right. So again, there's no vitality to these foods. They're not perishable. It's not like they're super powerhouses in nutrition or anything. Usually high in calories, maybe high in sugar and starch, depending on what kind of ingredients they're using. But they are low in toxins because they don't have these toxic oils. They don't have the preservatives. They don't have the wheat. They don't have the things they're trying to avoid. And they're also going to be low in nutrients, right? Then we move into what is technically processed food, but they're healthy processed foods. So like our healthy traditional fats, canned coconut milk. I mean, it's in a can, it's processed, but it's totally fine. It's actually really good for you. Cheese would be considered processed. You know, sometimes processed meats, you know, like cured meats and things, extremely healthful, but still considered processed. But they actually, you know, have a little bit of vitality. They may have some perishability. They're low in toxins and very high in nutrients and high in beneficial fats and things like that. And you can consume those things without guilt, like no problem whatsoever. But the majority of things that we want to consume ideally are going to be unprocessed, fresh, real food. Okay, and these things can start from frozen, but they have max vitality, which means they're very perishable. They're usually lower or higher in calories, depending on what kind of food they are. Definitely low in toxins compared to processed foods and have maximum nutrients that the body can use. Okay. So we always want to choose things made with better ingredients, avoiding the processed food realm. And I just want to address this question that we get a lot at this point in the beginning is like, you know, how important is it for me to buy organic or grass fed? I remember starting out, you know, I tried to make this pitch, you know, back in my early in my practice, you know, maybe 8, 9, 10 years ago, I was trying to get people to do more grass-fed and organic, but it just broke the bank. Like you go to the store and you try to get 100% grass-fed, grass-finished beef and things like that. You're paying, you know, $15, $25 a pound. And it was just not something that was sustainable. And what I've noticed is that even if you're on a really tight budget and you're buying conventional beef and conventional chicken and conventional eggs and conventional produce, you're still going to see all the changes that you're looking for. And yes, it is better from a quality standpoint, because it's going to be slightly lower in toxins and maybe higher in nutrients and better for the planet to buy better quality upgrades. But that doesn't have to be the focus in the beginning. The focus is just real food. And so that's what I'm trying to say here is that we want to move away from processed food, buy things made with better ingredients, ultimately buy real food, regardless of whether it's the best quality we can get. And then once we get really comfortable with real food in general, we can start to strategize our quality upgrades. And then, or maybe, you know, we're just much more efficient with our spending and we can start to purchase a little bit better quality meats and produce and stuff like that. Okay. So we have this concept, nutritional vitality, and this is in the community, but we're going to redo it because we did it at the beginning of this year when the whole COVID thing started. But basically what we're saying is we can assess a food based on the nutrients that it has, the toxic level that it has, and then whether it helps us with fat burning or whether it is going in the opposite direction of fat burning. So this is what we're talking about at this point is the toxins thing. And remember in our talk yesterday, we talked about how the reason that we call our toxins toxins in the first place is because they damage cells, they damage tissues, organs, and systems. They inhibit the assimilation and usage of nutrients. And they also deplete nutrients in the body because when we detoxify toxins, we have to bind them to certain nutrients and minerals. And it's a very depleting process in and of itself. So the reason that we avoid toxins is because the toxins damage us and they mess with our nutrients. All right, so the main toxins that we see in the standard American diet we have listed here: refined cereal grains, industrial seed oils, excess sugar, processed soy, pesticides, heavy metals, industrial pollutants, chemicals, preservatives, and dyes. And Arnica, you'll be very happy to see that we have our popcorn there front and center. All right, so we covered, and I'm not saying popcorn's off the table. I'm just trying to make a joke there. All right. So we covered yesterday our foods to avoid. So this is why we call our foods to avoid the foods to avoid, because they are toxic. They're not contributing to nutrition in any way, and they're very high in toxins. One of the things that we need to always look for, this is one of our deal breakers, probably the most important thing that we want to avoid when we're reading labels, is going to be these toxic fats and oils. So margarine, Crisco, all the fake butters and spreads, and then the highly processed industrial, I don't know why they call them vegetable oils because there's nothing vegetable about them. The highly processed seed oils, all right, so things like canola, corn, soybean, vegetable, grapeseed, safflower, and rice bran. Sunflower oil can be acceptable if it's listed as high oleic or high stearic. That means it's higher in monounsaturated fats and it's a little bit more protected. But in general, probably not the most optimal option. Sunflower, just listed as sunflower by itself, is something we probably want to avoid because it's very high in omega-6s. So I just want to go on a small tangent here because this is very important. Why is it so important to avoid these fats and oils? Well, you know, up till past couple of years, the most current understanding on insulin resistance and diabetes and pre-diabetes and a lot of these chronic degenerative diseases, cardiovascular disease, a lot of the blame was being put on carbohydrates and refined carbohydrates. And there's definitely, we're definitely consuming too much of those things. But what we're noticing now is that it may be just as much attributed to these toxic fats or more, because this is what happens. When our bodies take up these toxic fats, our bodies don't really know the difference initially. And so we build ourselves with these toxic fats and we build our cell membranes with these toxic fats. And we try to use these toxic fats for energy. And because we're building ourselves with these toxic fats, our mitochondria can't use these fats properly. And so it inhibits the body's ability to use fat for fuel, which makes it more dependent upon carbohydrates and glucose. And so consuming these toxic fats and oils contribute just as much or more towards insulin resistance and diabetes and cardiovascular disease as carbohydrates do. And as you already know, carbohydrates, we don't think carbohydrates are a problem. We just want to have our basic rules around them. But these are absolute deal breakers. And this is what most people are consuming when they're going out to restaurants and they're eating processed food. When you read ingredients and labels, these fats are on almost all food products. If you go to most restaurants and you ask them and you really try to dig into what it is they use to cook their foods and fry their foods in, almost always it's going to be canola oil or soybean oil or a combination of those because it's very cheap. And unintentionally, I think a lot of these places just don't realize how damaging these fats are. So I would say this is a deal breaker when you're shopping and reading ingredients. And it doesn't matter where you shop. What we're going to learn today, you can take these rules anywhere. You can shop at Smith's, Winco, Bonds, Walmart, and of course, like the health food stores like Natural Grocers and Whole Foods and stuff like that. So this is kind of maybe in a random order to you, but this is the way that I go through the store sometimes with my clients. So I'm going to pull up some examples. We have a marinara sauce here. Yes, making your own marinara would be the best thing possible, but brutally simple. Like, I don't know how many of us have the time to do that and to use it all before it goes bad, right? So if I look at the list of ingredients here, the 365 from Whole Foods has a pretty solid list of ingredients, and the oil they use in here or the fat they use in here is extra virgin olive oil. So totally checks out. So if you want to buy some store-bought marinara, just read the ingredients, all right? Make sure it has a simple list and approved fat. Now, what's interesting is within this same brand of Whole Foods Market, we have another marinara that's not organic. I don't think the organic or non-organic is very important, but what we see in here is expeller-pressed soybean oil. So this is completely off limits. Even though I might think, you know, Whole Foods brand, okay, it's got an approved option, they must all be approved, I always need to read the fine print on the label, okay? So even within brands, things change. Always read the ingredients and don't take your own word for it. It's like they change over time. I've seen things that went from approved to non-approved because they changed something about the ingredients. Soy sauces, like absolutely. For the longest time, we didn't even allow soy sauce. By the way, traditional soy sauce is supposed to be fermented, and that fermentation process mitigates the problematic anti-nutrients and phytoestrogenic properties of soy. But traditional soy sauce is fermented with wheat, okay? So we have the gluten issue in soy sauce. But if you get organic tamari gluten-free soy sauce, it is traditional soy sauce that is fermented soybeans without the wheat, all right? So it is soy sauce. It tastes like soy sauce because it is soy sauce. They just don't use wheat in the processing. So if you want a soy sauce alternative, you can get a real soy sauce. I have this in my fridge and I love to use it all the time. You can also do coconut aminos. A lot of people love the flavor of coconut aminos, slightly different. To me, it's a little bit slightly sweeter tasting, but coconut aminos are made from coconut and totally fine too, okay? Sriracha sauces. Arnica loves sriracha. What do we call it? The Arnica sauce is the combo of ketchup and sriracha mixed together. It's really, really good. But some other sauces, fish sauce, if you've never used it, it smells like fish, but it doesn't taste like fish. It tastes really good. Has a very unique flavor. I think the Japanese called it, I don't know why I feel like Chandler, you would know what this is. It's like umami or something like that, some unique flavor that's different from all the other flavors. So fish sauce, great. Sriracha sauces, you just got to read the ingredients. Check this Ninja Squirrel right here, and it all checks out. We actually love the coconut version here. Really, really good. Frozen stuff. So not a big fan of frozen meals. And obviously, there's things like enchiladas and pizzas and stuff that we're just not going to touch because they're just made with crap, right? But there are some out there, if you read the ingredients, to check out. Primal Kitchen actually has come out with a whole section of pre-cooked meals that you can just throw in the microwave or throw in the oven. And by the way, Primal Kitchen is a brand that you'll see come up a lot today. There's some online food prep, you know, companies. I think we have a post in the group that has a list of all the different online food prep companies. Balanced Bites has a really good food delivery thing that comes in little pre-made meals like this. So not a fan of fake foods. Like the fake chickens and the fake meats and the Beyond Burgers and stuff, like usually not going to be made with the best ingredients. Like if you want something that tastes like a burger, then try to have a burger. Now, if you're someone like Chandler, you know, who's a dedicated vegan and is just not going to introduce meat, then there's a way to be a smart vegan about it. You just have to, same rules apply with what we're talking about here. You would want to read the ingredients because there are some vegan products out there that actually check out. Okay. Ice creams made with wholesome ingredients, things like Halo Top is a low sugar ice cream. It's sweetened with, they use a combination sometimes of stevia, monk fruit, xylitol, erythritol. And you got to be careful with some of those sugar alcohols because some people get some digestive issues from them, but Halo Top usually checks out. But you do have to read the ingredients because I did notice there were some flavors that had some off ingredients, like some wheat or something like that. And then they also have a non-dairy Halo Top if dairy causes you issues. Coconut Bliss is a great ice cream brand made with coconut milk, and so it's dairy-free, so delicious, really, really good. Usually most of them are very low sugar because they use stevia and xylitol. And then if you want a real deal ice cream, Strauss is probably our number one go-to. There's some others like Jenny's, and you can just read ingredients and figure it out yourself. We just kind of gravitate towards some really solid quality brands that we have some experience with. So Strauss is a really, really good ice cream. Dangerous though, I'm telling you, like in the beginning, most of us would keep that kind of stuff in the freezer and have an intention to have just a little bit here and there. And it's almost like it's impossible not to eat the whole pint, you know? So if you're going to do something like that, I'd say do it as a treat, eat the thing, be done with it. Don't mess with it for another month or a couple months or something like that. Dark chocolate, totally fine. One little caveat, this is in the guide. Some people don't notice it. We do avoid soy. We're okay with soy lecithin, and we're okay with sunflower lecithin. This is kind of like an emulsifier, and we don't see any problems with it. If you have any questions about that, I can send you a couple articles and some good scientific papers. It does not contain the things that we're trying to avoid in soy and that we're trying to avoid in sunflower. So a lot of chocolate chips and chocolate bars you'll see. Everything checks out, and then you'll see soy lecithin, so that's totally fine. If you haven't tried Lily's, some of you that are new to this real food realm, Lily's has chocolate bars, chocolate chips, and they're made with good ingredients and sweetened with stevia, sometimes with xylitol or erythritol, and they taste freaking amazing. I mean, it's one of our favorite chocolate bars, zero sugar. I mean, you could literally eat an entire chocolate bar, and you're not going to get any sugar. You may get some digestive issues from these sugar alcohols, but we love it. So approved flours. So you'll notice in the group, we have a lot of like, you know, waffles, pancakes, rolls, breads, and things like that. We're just not using wheat flour. We're replacing that with something else. Someone that you may come to recognize in the group is Adam Prusan. He's experimented with a lot of different flour combinations. What we found to work is equal parts white rice flour, tapioca, cassava. And then I think we're throwing in some modified tapioca flour because it gives it a little bit of a gluten feel to it because it's like stretchy and sticky or something like that. But you can experiment with all these different flours. And I used to not be a big flour person, but now we've been experimenting because we have people asking for it with like different rolls and breads and things like that. So all these flours are totally fine. You can find them at most health food stores, grocery stores. All right. Something else to be aware of comes up a lot. You know, most of us understand we have to give up tortillas, but there are tortillas made with good ingredients. The Siete line, they have like three or four different versions. They have a cassava flour one. They're all use cassava flour, but they have one that's a cashew flour. That's can't remember what the other one is. Almond flour, and they all taste amazing. You heat them up in a skillet. You can have a taco night, tortilla night. If we're looking for a corn tortilla, the problem with corn is that if we want to consume corn, it has to be organic or non-GMO. And ideally, it's got to be nixtamalized, all right? Nixtamalized means that, so our ancestors, the Indians over here that used to eat a lot of maize, you know, corn, they didn't just eat corn off the cob, right? When they ate corn, they understood what it would do to their digestive system. So that what they would do is they would lay the corn out and dry it out, and then they would crush it into a powder, and then they would soak that in a lime juice, because first of all, the crushing and drying out, that is kind of like cooking, and that would mitigate some of the anti-nutrients associated with corn, because corn is a grain. But then when you soak the flour in lime juice, that acidic medium also contributes to kind of denaturing a lot of those anti-nutrients. So this brand right here is a sprouted corn tortilla that has been nixtamalized, and that's the most optimal version of a corn tortilla we can find. So not something you'd want to consume every day, but on occasion, if you want to have a taco night and use corn tortillas, this would be the brand. I haven't found any other one that is nixtamalized and sprouted, okay? And then the Siete line, great. Yesterday, I think Madi asked, like, how many tortillas can we do in an evening if we're trying to, or in a day if we're trying to moderate our carbohydrate intake? I would say probably like two tortillas for a meal, okay? That would be equivalent to a decent amount of starch, right? By the way, Arnica and I are doing breakfast for lunch today, and we'll be having some fruit and some pancakes and stuff like that. So, all right, I'm just gonna tab over real quick, see if we have any questions. Dun, 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 dun. Oh, we got two questions, cool. Why is stevia okay? Because stevia is a leaf. So stevia is a plant-based non-nutritive sweetener. It's not an artificial sweetener. I don't know if you need more detail on that, let me know. Riley asks, are we at any recommended brands for chocolate? Not really. So what we're looking for when it comes to chocolate is gonna be, I would say lower sugar, higher cocoa, better. But the higher you get with the cocoa, usually the less sweet it tastes. So you have to find a balance there. I would say somewhere above 60% cocoa is going to be ideal. I'm going to show you a couple brands that we really like. The Lilies is a really good brand. Endangered Species. The other one's slipping my mind right now. But I got a couple pictures in here we're going to go through, okay? Cool. All right. Now, did that answer your question, Natasha? Let me know. Stevia is a plant-based non-nutritive sweetener. Just like monk fruit extract. Okay, cool. All right, so let's get back over. Thank you for asking those questions. Now let's talk about some condiments. This is what makes this way of doing things so great, because you think you can't do all this stuff and this is such an austere way of doing things, but we can. We can have these things. They just need to be made with the right ingredients. And we're not doing a massive amount of this stuff, you know? So this reminds me of a conversation I remember, Mindy, you'll appreciate this, I had with Ryan Duplex one time. And he said something about, yo, bro, you're using barbecue sauce, you know, with your whatever, pork or something like that. And I was like, yeah. He's like, well, doesn't it have sugar in it? I was like, yeah, but I mean, the sugar is minimal and I'm not eating a bowl of barbecue sauce. And I said, dude, let's do an experiment. We'll go an entire month. I'll have a tablespoon of barbecue sauce with my meat every night and you don't have it. And let's see what kind of different changes we experience. It's negligible. So a lot of these things, you know, we're not consuming them in massive amounts. We're consuming them as complements to a real food way of eating. And so to make this work for a lifetime, I think it's perfectly appropriate to have this stuff in here, because if we are ultra restrictive, most people wouldn't stick with something like this. So ketchups, we just need to read the ingredients. This Whole Food Brands version checks out. Heinz has a couple brands that check out. I think it's called Simply Heinz. So there's other grocery stores that are gonna have some ketchups that check out. You just have to read the ingredients. Does have a little bit of sugar in it. I think it's like a teaspoon per tablespoon or something like that, but it's not a huge deal. We see this brand Primal Kitchen again. By the way, Primal Kitchen is created by the Primal Methodology, which is Mark Sisson and Mark's Daily Apple. And Mark founded the Primal Methodology years ago. I was following him when he first started his blog, and now it's probably one of the most popular blogs on the planet. So anything that Primal puts out is going to check out. And it doesn't mean don't read the ingredients. I'd still read the ingredients out of curiosity. But anything that you see Primal Kitchen based is going to check out. So they have a great ketchup that has no sugar added. It tastes amazing. It's pretty expensive. Sometimes you can find it at Costco, which is a really good buy. Mustards completely check out depending on what brand they are. Here I've got the example for the organic Whole Foods 365 version. You can see a very simple list of ingredients. Primal Kitchen has a spicy brown mustard. Even French's mustard, last time I checked, checks out, okay? So mayonnaise, I love mayonnaise. Chosen Foods is a really good brand, by the way. When you see them out there, they're salad dressings. Usually they use avocado oil. So Chosen Foods has an avocado oil-based mayo. I feel like that tastes a little bit more like Miracle Whip than mayonnaise, but and then Primal Kitchen has a mayo, which is amazing. It tastes just like mayo because it is mayo. They just replace crappy oils with avocado oil. All right. So, and this is an example of a mayo. The reason most mayos are not approved is because when we look at the ingredients, we have our toxic oils. We usually have soybean oil or canola oil or something along those lines, right? Other than that oil, I mean, this thing would check out right here. Salad dressings. Now, what's really cool is that we have this grassroots movement for real food, and we have, you know, the paleo, the primal, the low carb keto movements, the carnivore movement. They're gaining more and more traction, so we're starting to see a lot more food products out there. I remember when I started this, 10 years ago, there was nothing like this out there. You know, you had to make everything from scratch. So now we have several brands that are approved dressings, but the only one that I recommend is the Primal Kitchen series because it's solid. I know the company and they have such a huge variety of different salad dressings, all made with great ingredients. If you like creamy, they got a bunch of creamy options. If you like vinaigrettes, they got a bunch of vinaigrette options. So I think this is really the only brand that you need, but Noble Made makes some good ones. Chosen Foods makes some good ones, but you are not lacking anything when it comes to salad dressings. The only thing you might be lacking would be like a homemade creamy ranch or a homemade creamy blue cheese. And we have recipes for those inside the community. And they're super simple to make, even dairy-free ones. Still talking about condiments, barbecue sauces. So again, there's a lot of different companies out there. I've got some pictures of some in here. We used to always recommend the bone sucking sauce. I still think that's my favorite. It's like just a traditional sweet barbecue sauce. Primal Kitchen has a couple there. They're really tangy and vinegary, so some people don't like that. Noble Made, again, makes some good ones. Usually if you see something that says paleo, it's gonna check out, but I would still read the ingredients. So there's a lot of barbecue options out there. We'll have links to this inside the community. And then hot sauces. Siete, the same people that make the chips and make the tortillas, they have a really cool hot sauce line. Things like Cholula and Tabasco, all check out. And then we see here, Noble Made is a really good hot buffalo spicy wing sauce. So again, it all boils down to just reading ingredients and then trying maybe to stick within brands that you kind of trust. We don't recommend canned beans, okay? So yesterday, Madi had asked about, like, what about, like, pinto beans and lentils and things like that. I think they're totally fine. You'll notice that it's in our guide as, it's at the top right, mirroring our little five food groups. But they need to be made from scratch, meaning you need to get the dried beans and you need to soak them for 24 hours because that soaking process is crucial to mitigating a lot of the anti-nutrients in beans. A lot of the canned bean options that we see, they typically are not going to go through that soaking process. They take their beans, they put them in the vats, and they boil them right away. The soaking process actually mimics a seed being out in nature and getting water, and so it lowers its defenses, and it starts to naturally lower the anti-nutrients contained in those beans. All right, so beans are fine, you just want to make them yourself. Coconut milk is something that most of us are going to keep in-house, on hand, in the pantry, non-perishable, so lasts for a pretty significant time. You have the full fat and the light versions. Usually we recommend going for the full fat because we want the real deal. What you'll notice though, like with this light coconut milk here, we found that it's a little bit, the consistency is a little bit more liquidy. So if you're using it for a coffee creamer, the light version might be an option, not because you're trying to avoid fat, but because you're not trying to have these big chunks that fall out of the can. So coconut milk, you know, something good to have around. Noodles. So if you're looking for a noodle, you can find something that's made with white rice, and that would be perfectly fine as well. And there's several different options you might stumble across here and there. Very high in starch, very high in carbohydrates, not something you'd want to use all the time, but to treat yourself here and there, totally appropriate. Vinegars, I haven't seen a vinegar that doesn't check out. Some are a little bit sweeter than others. You know, balsamic is usually a little bit more sweeter. A sugar zealot would be like, you know, oh my gosh, I have so much sugar, so I'm not going to use that. Well, what we'd say is you're using so little of it with your salad and your salad dressing, it really is not that big a deal. So balsamic vinegar, totally fine. All the other vinegars, usually fine. I would still read the ingredients just to make sure it's not tainted with something else. Now, olive oil. So I haven't really found much of a need for olive oil anymore because we cook with butter and ghee. You know, salad dressings, we use pre-made salad dressings most of the time, unless we're making like a creamy ranch or something. So we do have some olive oil in house, and sometimes we find it hard to find uses for it. So, but if you want an olive oil to keep on hand and you like making your own dressings and maybe you like to finish your foods or something like that with some olive oil, I think that's perfectly fine, very helpful. Just make sure you get a good quality brand. There's a group of guys a few years ago that went out, they had a website called truthinoliveoil.com. They don't have that anymore, but they actually tested a lot of the brands of olive oils out there, and they found that the majority of them were blended with soybean oil. And the reason for that is because of labeling laws here in America. When you see something that says 100% olive oil or made with 100% olive oil, all that means is that one ingredient is 100% olive oil, and you can also have other things in there, you know? So again, it helps to find a company that is vetted and that you know is trying to stay true to some principles. And California Olive Ranch was one of the ones that checked out. It was very good quality. And also when it comes to olive oils, ideally, because it's a lot of monounsaturated fat, you're looking for something fresh. And what I like about them is they have on the back a press date and then also a use by date. Ideally, you're using olive oil within a year of its press date or harvest date. Coconut oil, like grape. We use it for some things. And then what we ideally are looking for with coconut oil is going to be virgin, which means it's first pressed, cold pressed. It's basically mashed. There's not a lot of heat that goes into it. There's no solvents. Anytime you see something that says refined, usually that means they're using a solvent. Sometimes they're using hexane or something like that. So when it comes to coconut oil, look for virgin. I love this brand, Nutiva. It's a really good company. If you go on Amazon, you'll see huge bottles and buckets of it, and it's not going to go bad. You can keep that in your pantry forever. It does get solid when it gets cooler. And then ghee is amazing. We love ghee. Ghee is butter with the milk solids removed from it. So you'll notice when you cook with butter, sometimes it will turn brown and smoke, and I don't think there's anything wrong with that at all, but that's the milk solids cooking out of it. Ghee has been clarified, removed of the milk solids. And so if someone's really, really sensitive to dairy, they may have a problem with butter. I do have a lot of clients that are dairy intolerant, but butter is totally fine because it has such small amounts of milk solids in it. But ghee is a great option to use, and we use that sometimes. Avocado oil, totally fine. But again, now if I'm trying to keep things brutally simple, I don't see a reason to have a bunch of different oils and fats on hand, because now I got to stress out about making sure I use them before they go bad, right? So I don't see a purpose in having butter and ghee and coconut oil and olive oil and avocado oil, because it's like, why would I use which one for what purpose, right? For the majority of my cooking, I'm going to use butter or ghee. And then for salads, I'm using salad dressing. And I may have some olive oil on hand for some finishing, or I'm not sure what we'd use it for right now, if we're making a homemade dressing or something like that. But you can use avocado oil. Here we see Primal Kitchen has a version out, Chosen Foods, and there's some several others out there. These are trusted though. The other ones might be mixed with something. Really, when it comes to cooking, butter and ghee are all you need, right? Butter is just, it's a nutritional powerhouse. If you're slightly sensitive to it, then ghee would be a good option, and you still keep the flavor of butter and you have the milk solids removed. And then randomly thrown in here, I know, but there are some approved gums out there. There's a couple of others that aren't up here, but these are the ones that we got the most positive feedback from. Simply Gum, a little bit of sugar in it, pure, sweetened with some sugar alcohol, so no sugar, and they're great, all right? Chocolate is in the deal. So I'm looking here because Riley had asked about like brands. What is one of my favorites? Lily's is awesome. We love Lily's. And then Endangered Species. And there's one other that me and Arnica like. I think I have it on the next slide here. Oh, yeah. Alter Ego is a really good one. And you'll see here, like, one of our favorite flavors is this mint crisp. And the sugars here per serving are going to be, where are we at? total sugars is 5, added sugars 5, 5 grams, right? So that's not much sugar at all. And that means a third of the bar has about 5 grams of sugar. And I'd say that's about all you'd want to consume. I usually tell my clients maybe about when you're consuming some chocolate, like 6 grams of sugar per serving or something like that. That will allow you to have some fruit and other stuff, okay? But again, it all comes down to reading the ingredients. If we look at the ingredients on here real quick, everything checks out. No soy lecithin, which would have been fine. But there's a lot of different options out there. Lily's, the original dark chocolate, absolutely love. It's so good. Zero sugar in it. All right. So the ingredients here we see, and there's some little things in here. I think they're in the guide now. Inulin, totally fine. Dextrin, totally fine. Erythritol is a sugar alcohol. We got some sunflower lecithin, which we mentioned before, totally fine. So this completely checks out. And you see here, this Lily's 55% cocoa and it has zero sugar in it. So you could literally eat the whole bar and you'd be totally fine, but I don't know how your digestive system would feel. If you do half a bar, you'd be totally fine. All right, and then sparkling waters for soda replacements. LaCroix, pretty popular in the health food realm, holistic health realm, a lot of different flavors. They use really clean water, reverse osmosis, carbon filtrated. I think it's ozonated as well. And then they have a little bit of an essence of some flavors that get thrown in there. Zevia would be a great soda alternative. So, you know, Arnica and I have been together for like a year and a half or something like that. She's like, I can't believe I've never heard of Zevia. Zevia is sweet tasting because it has stevia in it, but it's no calorie because stevia is a no calorie sweetener. And they have just about every option you could freaking imagine. They have grape soda, they have cream soda, root beer, you know, like a Diet Coke version, a regular cola version, Mountain Dew, 7-Up. I mean, you name it and they got it, and they all taste really, really good, especially cold. You will notice some of them do have some caffeine, and they clearly mark that on the front, so you just need to be aware of that so that you're not drinking caffeine close to bedtime. Great for drink mixers, by the way. Love sparkling waters. If you're trying to come off of sodas and you like that fizzy bite, we are addicted to things like Topo Chico and Pellegrino. Love Gerald Steiner as well. Sometimes you can find some really good deals at Costco or Winco and some other discount places like that. All right. Bars. Everyone wants bars, you know, especially in the beginning so they can have something to carry around. I love Epic Meat Bars because Epic Meat Bars are basically meat packaged in a little bar. I think they taste way better than beef jerky. Some people don't like them. There's a lot of different flavors, a lot of different meats. I love this bacon and pork and egg yolks. So good. I love one of the beef ones. It's the beef habanero, but they have all kinds of different versions. They have a salmon bar, and I think they taste better than beef jerky, but that's an option for a bar. As we're transitioning through learning how to eat real food our way, it's very useful to have stuff like this on hand just in case you have a moment, like a low blood sugar moment, and you need something and you don't have anything readily available. Instead of hitting the gas station and getting something crappy, you can have some of this in your backpack or your purse or in your office drawer or something like that. Another great option is going to be Primal Kitchen. They have a series of collagen bars. This has a whole scoop of collagen in each bar. I think they taste great. They taste very unique. Some people don't like them, but that's a really good option, low in sugar. Bulletproof has some amazing bars. These things almost taste too good. They're sweetened with some erythritol and xylitol, I think. I get a little bit of a digestive issue when I consume these. I've tried them out. You know, they taste really good. Some people love them, though. But again, a scoop of collagen in them. I think, what does it say here, 2 grams of sugar in that bar. And then we have things like Laura bars. So Laura bars would be like the whole food, real food version of a dessert bar, like a Snickers bar, because they're usually sweet with dates or fruit or something like that, but very minimal ingredients. Like this cashew cookie here has 2 ingredients, cashews and dates, and it's really good. And they have a lot of different versions, peanut butter and jelly and chocolate chip cookie dough and fudge brownie, and they're all really good and just made with a very, very simple list of ingredients. Because they do have a lot of sugar, usually not something you want to consume all day, or not something you want to consume multiple bars at a time. But if you're looking for that sweet, you know, kind of bar taste or have a craving for it, that would be a really, really good option. And then as we're looking for chips, remember, we're just looking for things made with better ingredients. Siete chips are where it's at. This would be your traditional dipping chip for guacamole, for salsa, and they have a lot of different versions. The best one, I think, for guacamole and salsa would probably be the sea salt or the lime one, but then they also have some different flavors, some nacho flavors. They came out with a fuego, like a almost like a hot Doritos flavor, so a bunch of different varieties and versions there. Very high in starch, so not something you want to consume all the time. If you're doing like a taco day and you want to have a taco bowl with a bowl of or a big handful of siete chips, that would be totally fine. Probably wouldn't want to do more than that. A lot of us have had to learn the hard way. Keeping these in the house can be extremely dangerous because it's very hard just to eat a few. And then if you're looking for a traditional potato chip, Boulder has some that are out. There's a couple companies that use coconut oil. Some will use avocado oil. I would not buy anything that's made with olive oil because they use high heat to fry these chips. Olive oil is a little bit more delicate. All right. So, but ideally you're looking for something that's cooked in coconut oil. Jackson's Honest has a bunch of different versions. And again, Boulder has some coconut oil based potato chips. So, and again, very high in starch. It's made with potatoes. Totally fine. It's cooked in an appropriate oil. If the seasonings check out, totally fine, but not something you want to consume all the time and very dangerous to keep in the house. Now, one of my favorites, pork rinds. So pork rinds completely in the deal. Traditional pork rinds, the way they're supposed to be made is supposed to be pork skins cooked in their own fat. Now, a lot of pork rinds that you see in gas stations, when you read the list of ingredients, it's just got this very long list of ingredients and a bunch of stuff that we don't even understand or recognize. But there's some traditional companies out there. Epic is a really good line. The same people that make those meat bars, they have a really good line of pork rinds. I love their salt and pepper one, their barbecue one. They have some cracklings, which are a little bit more condensed. That taste amazing. Love both the jalapeno and the maple bacon one. And then 4505 is another really good brand, and all their different varieties check out. So you think about what pork rinds are. If we have an aversion to that, it's just because we've been brainwashed to think that pork and fat and meat and all this stuff are bad. But now that we understand the truth, pork rinds are perfectly appropriate because it's basically just pork skin cooked in its own fat. And then if you're looking for crackers, crackers are kind of hard to come by, something that tastes good. One that I found that I feel like we like is these Hugh Kitchen grain-free crackers. They have some that have a little bit of seasonings in it, which is totally fine. So if you're looking for something that you can put a little bit of cheese on or something, this would be a good option. There's another brand out there. It used to be called Jill's Crackers. I think they moved on to Julian's Bakery. I don't like those as much. They're really nutty and seedy, but they're fine. It's all about just reading ingredients, okay? The reason we opt for real food versus non-real foods and even healthful processed foods to the best of our abilities is because, remember, we're trying to give the body nutrients and we're trying to teach the body how to use fat for fuel. Remember, we talked yesterday about the best sources of nutrients. We like to use this concept of nutritional vitality to assess a food, all right? So what are the possible things that we can consume? Well, if we look at the spectrum, we've got real food, regardless of what your definition of real food is. Real food is not fake food or processed food. We've also got processed foods. We've got what I would consider engineered health foods, things that are marketed as health foods, maybe slightly healthier than processed foods. And then we've got supplements. I think we can all agree that there's probably not anything outside of this spectrum as far as things we could possibly consume. So then the question is, what's optimal within this realm? And the common sense answer, I feel like, is real food. And then throwing in some strategic supplements, as long as they're really good quality supplements, would be beneficial. But that's how we come up with our definition of real food. So remember, this processed food spectrum, we're trying to stay in the healthy processed foods and the fresh real food spectrum. And every now and then we're bouncing in and out of this process with better ingredients spectrum that may not have a lot of nutritional value, but at least it's not toxic like the ultra processed foods. All right, so let's talk about the produce department. Just a few tips and strategies here. First of all, fresh versus frozen, I would say that it does not matter. To make this work in a modern lifestyle, if it's more convenient for you to have some frozen cauliflower florets and broccoli florets and mixed vegetables in the freezer that you can just throw into a skillet, cook in some butter or coconut oil and some salt and pepper, I think as far as like the freshness component and the nutritional value, it's a wash. because fresh produce has to be picked, it has to be stored, it has to be shipped. Sometimes it's picked unripe so that it can ripen on the way. It loses nutritional value as it does that. Frozen produce usually is picked at the peak of ripeness and blanched or flash frozen. And so I would say it's just, it doesn't matter. It just eat real food, just eat vegetables, eat produce. You know, when I do a lot of produce, usually I'll have a mix of some fresh stuff along with some backup stuff in the freezer, like some cauliflower or something like that. Now, when it comes to produce, if you're trying to mix things up and keep things excited, one way to do that is just to get some variety through seasonality. And one way to do that is to go into most grocery stores, and what they usually have on display is what is in season. Although now that we can have produce any time of year, all throughout the year, you know, it's kind of hard to determine what's in season and what's not. So a really, really good resource, I have this bookmarked on my phone and on my computer, is seasonalfoodguide.org. And when you pull up seasonalfoodguide.org and you enter your state and you enter your the time of month, right now we're in early January, it's going to tell you everything that theoretically would be in season in your area of the world. And so that would be a really good way to kind of determine which produce you want to experiment with, is just trying to go by the produce that's in season. Now, if we want to try to strategize our organic purchases, a lot of people will ask, you know, how do I know which things to get organic? Do I need to try to buy everything organic, or is it not that important? Remember we talked about before, I think the most important thing that we need to do is just eat real food without getting too caught up in and being too neurotic about making sure that it's the best quality every time. And not to say that it's not beneficial, but one way that we can strategize our organic purchases is by using the EWG's Dirty Dozen and Clean 15. So the EWG is a really great resource, EWG.org. We'll have this in the resources in the post associated with this inside the community. I'll also send it out as an email. But the EWG, like, they do a lot of great stuff. They go out every year and they test all the popular produce for herbicides and pesticides and irradiation. And they don't just test the outside, they test inside the plant. And they come out with this list of their Dirty Dozen and Clean 15. So their Dirty Dozen is the dirtiest produce on the planet, meaning that it has the most pesticides and herbicides, meaning that if you want something on this Dirty Dozen list, you absolutely need to purchase it organic, because otherwise it has so many toxins in it, you probably are going to experience symptoms from consuming it. And I do have clients that sometimes will eat a conventional strawberry and have an immediate breakout or an immediate migraine. And so the point here is that if I want strawberries, then based on this sheet, I would want to buy organic. And if I don't have access to organic strawberries, then I'm just not going to buy strawberries. Apples are always usually at the top of the list. Spinach is usually at the top of the list. Grapes. And so, you know, we were trying to find some grapes for, you know, the Good Luck New Year's Day food thing that we're trying to put together. And we just could not find any organic grapes. So we skipped the grapes part of it. So what I would recommend is I'll send out a little PDF, and it's something that you can print and cut out and put into your purse or keep in your backpack or something. Or I think even more convenient would be to take a picture of this. And again, I'll send out an image, and you can also get your own from EWG. And then you can just crop that image and keep it on your phone. Over time, you'll get very comfortable with this list and remember which things you need to buy organic. By the way, where are we at? Potatoes. What was I going to say about potatoes? Oh, some potatoes can be GMO. So that might be why you want to buy most potatoes organic. Now, on the flip side, oh, by the way, so here's an example. If I look at some organic strawberries versus non-organic strawberries, the organic just happened to look better in this picture. A lot of times when I go into the grocery store, the non-organic look way bigger and way juicier and way more red, right? So it's hard to tell just by looking at it. And most people not knowing this information about pesticides and herbicides would probably just go with a cheaper version, right? But now knowing what we know, even though they look very similar, we're looking for that organic label, okay? Now, on the flip side of that, we have what they call their Clean 15. And the Clean 15 is their list of things that tested so low in pesticides and herbicides, they say that it's not necessary to buy organic. You can buy conventional. Avocados are almost always at the top of the list every year, which means that if you see avocados on sale and they're conventional, or if you're shopping at Walmart or Cardenas or, you know, a Mexican food store or something like that, and they got avocados super cheap, those are totally fine to buy conventional. And same with everything else that we see here. By the way, sweet corn, I would never buy conventional because corn, unless otherwise specified, is going to be genetically modified. So anytime we buy corn, it needs to be non-GMO organic. But, you know, pretty simple list here. Again, you'll get very familiar with it. If I look at the difference between price on avocados, you know, avocados, like there's a significant price difference between organic and non-organic. So usually when we get avocados, we're going to get the conventional version. All right. Now, just some pro tips on purchasing produce. I can't even tell you how many times I've had a client sign up with me and they get so excited to, you know, start this way of eating. They go out and they spend $300 in the grocery store. They pack their grocery or refrigerator full of produce and meats and things like that. And then within like 5 days, half of it goes bad. So I think what you want is you want to buy in small batches and you want to buy hearty produce that won't go bad easy. So things like carrots and cabbage and cauliflower and broccoli. Broccoli kind of goes bad fast, but celery, what else is in there? You know, I don't know, just things that are very, very hearty. The ingredients of the Bobar salad are very hearty. That's why, that's part of the reason we put it together, because it keeps really well for a long time. Bobar salad is a recipe that's in the guide. It's also in the community. But just as a tip here, I would say buy things that are hearty, that don't go bad easy, and that you can use very easy. You know, so if I take a head of cabbage or a head of cauliflower and I go home and I just chop a big chunk of it off and then chop it up into small pieces and throw it in a skillet with some butter and salt and pepper, it tastes absolutely amazing. Or I could throw some meat in there with it too. So just trying to keep things simple and hearty. All you need is salt, butter, salt, and pepper, maybe some garlic powder to season things up. A dish of broccoli cooked in butter with salt and pepper is amazing. You could throw in some ground beef and you have a whole dish right there. Super, super simple. If we're going to do greens, or when we do greens, then I usually recommend just getting those pre-washed boxes, triple washed or whatever, of greens and cycling through different versions. You've got spring mixes, you've got things mixed with spinach, you've got kale, you've got arugula. I love arugula. I love this Organic Girl Super Greens. It's got chard and mustard greens and things like that in there. And what I like about these is they're boxes that are they're small enough that you can go through it before they go bad. And so in an evening, you can take a handful of greens, some approved salad dressing, some chopped up nuts, a little bit of goat cheese or crumbled blue cheese or something like that. And voila, you got yourself an amazing little salad that, by the way, someone would charge you freaking $15 at a restaurant to serve you. And you can make it just as good at home or even better because you put your own TLC into it. We love our safe starches. The more I understand what it is that we're doing, the more I'm learning to allow people to embrace carbohydrates, because I don't think carbs are the problem that we used to think they are. The amounts can be a problem, but I would take advantage of stuff like sweet potatoes and yams and regular potatoes, which I would buy organic, and squashes and things like that. Because if we stick to our rules of measuring it out to 3/4 of a cup max per day, we're still going to be low carb. We're going to learn about that in our low carb section, how much carbs are in these different foods. And you're going to see that it's still relatively low carb. So definitely take advantage of these. By the way, to keep things brutally simple, all right, when you bake a potato, you do not have to wrap it in foil or plastic or poke holes in it. All you have to do is turn on the oven to 350, take your potato, put it on the grates, or you can put it on a cookie sheet just in case, you know, sometimes they'll have some stuff leak out of them and it'll dirty up your oven. But all you have to do is put it in there, put it on 350, bake it for 35 to 45 minutes until you can squeeze it with an oven mitt and it's soft. And there you go. Boom. You have a cooked potato. Brutally simple. And then one of our favorite ways to cook sweet potatoes is to chop it up into cubes, throw it into a skillet. Kind of helps to pre-oven bake it for a little bit, but you can put it in a skillet and cook it with butter until it gets nice and soft, salt and pepper, and it's freaking amazing. White rices. We didn't talk a lot about this yesterday, and we usually don't talk about this until, I can't remember when it is in the progression, maybe like third or fourth meeting. But we talk a lot about anti-nutrients and plant toxins, okay? The reason that we prefer white rice over brown rice is because brown rice, the reason it's brown is because it still has the shell and the hull and the husk, or at least parts of it. And that's where the plant puts a lot of its defense mechanisms, its anti-nutrients. So white rice has been stripped of the bran and the hull and the husk. And so it's really just starch, even though it does have a few other things in there. So it's a lot safer to consume, okay? And if you look all over the world at traditional populations, Japan, Asia, South Pacific Islands, Thailand, India, like they all consume white rice. Why do Americans Americans are the only ones that started this stupid brown rice craze. And the reason is because someone looked at brown rice and said, oh, there's a lot more, there's some nutrients in the whole in the bran and the husk, right? We got some fiber and some B vitamins and stuff like that. And it's true, there is some nutrients in the shell of seeds, but that doesn't mean that they're good to eat because there's also anti-nutrients in those shells. I could tell you that this drywall here has some freaking magnesium and phosphorus in it, but you're not going to eat it because it also has like other toxins in it, right? So the reason we like white rice is because it's very clean, and I think a lot of us do really well on it. We don't experience any digestive issues from it, so you can test that out. But our favorite's going to be jasmine. It cooks really nice and soft. You can experiment with arborio, basmati, sushi rice. Any of the white rices are going to be in play. Okay, long grain. All right, we are almost to the end. Let's keep going here, though. Let's talk about some bin stuff. Especially now, like you'll notice that Whole Foods and a lot of other places, they don't let you get your own self-serve bin stuff. So we have like nuts and seeds and dried fruit and beans and legumes. And what we need to be careful of is the ingredients on it. Okay, so if I look at a nut and it says that it's dry roasted, usually dry roasted implies that it does not use an oil. Okay, so dry roasted, if I look on the back of this, we've got dry roasted almonds. Sometimes it will contain some salt. Totally fine, right? All right, now here we see roasted. It does not say dry. So now I turn around on the back. Roasted usually implies, unless it says dry, usually implies some kind of an oil. Now in this situation, we do see high oleic sunflower oil. So this would be perfectly fine and appropriate. Not as good as roasting it in butter or coconut oil because they're more saturated, but this would check out. My point here is that you always need to read the ingredients. Usually dry roasted means it's just dry roasted with some salt. But if you see roasted usually implies an oil. And a lot of times you're going to see canola oil or soybean oil or something along those lines. Okay. Very important to avoid these toxic fats and oils. Pistachios, great. Pre-shell, doesn't matter. This is another example. We see cranberries. It looks like cranberries might be the only ingredient. If I turn it around, I look at what's in here. They have sunflower oil. So this would be a deal breaker, and we would not get these cranberries. Dried fruits, absolute love. I love dried apples. I love the Bear line here. Costco sometimes has huge bags of them. Freeze-dried fruits and things like that are great for little snacks and little desserts. And now let's just talk about the meat department real quick. So remember we talked yesterday about nutrition, and one of the big goals that we're trying to accomplish when we eat real food is giving the body nutrients. And we also talked about how animal meats and animal foods in general are extremely nutrient dense, the most nutrient dense of all the foods that we can consume. If we assess animal foods based on nutritional vitality, they have a lot of nutrients. They're usually relatively low in toxins, and they contribute great to metabolic flexibility and fat burning because they usually don't have much, if any, sugar or glucose in them. All right, so contrary to popular belief, red meat and pork are nutrient-dense foods and extremely healthful, okay? And it's worth experimenting, going through phases of doing a lot of red meat and a lot of pork and just seeing what you feel better on. Poultry is totally fine. I just don't think it's anywhere near as nutrient-dense as red meat and pork. And then ideally what we'd want to be doing over time is eating an animal nose to tail, because this animal is an animal from nose to tail. This animal is comprised of not just muscle meat, but also skin and nail and bone and hair and connective tissue and joints and ligaments and cartilage and stuff like that. So to give this body all those nutrients to build this body, it would help to eat an entire animal. Most of us probably are not comfortable doing that. So we have some ways that we can work around that. So when it comes to meat, first of all, we mentioned it yesterday in the talk, we always recommend fatty cuts, bone in, and skin on when possible. Now, that's not a deal breaker. If you have, like, we'll do chicken strip nights, you know, sometimes, you know, we love our little chicken fingers and it's not skin on and bone in. But in general, in theory, you just want to focus on nutrient packages, because when I eat fatty cuts of meat, I'm not just getting protein, I'm getting fat, I'm getting connective tissue. The reason that those fatty cuts of meat are fatty is because it's not just fat, it's also like ligaments and tendons and things mixed in there. When I eat bone in, I'm getting not just the meat, I'm getting minerals and nutrients from the bone that when I cook it, leach into the meat. So it's like giving it a mineral upgrade. And then again, skin on, a lot of skin. The collagen supplements that we take are derived from poultry and pork skin. So eating skin is going to be very beneficial because it gives us all the nutrients that we need to make our own skin, plus a lot of other good stuff. When I'm eating chicken bones and wings, I like to gnaw on the ends and eat the cartilage and stuff like that. So not mandatory. It's just a different way of thinking. Okay. Totally fine. Actually very, very good for you. Go with what fits your budget. So a lot of times if I take a client on a Whole Food shopping tour and we're looking at things and there's $19.99 a pound type stuff, it's like, I couldn't afford that. We rarely get anything that's like that. So we try to find what's on sale. And so maybe just shop according to your budget. If chicken breasts or chicken, fingers or strips are on sale, then go for it, because maybe you're trying to save some money there. All cuts are great, you know, but fatty cut, bone in, skin on would be ideal from a nutritional value standpoint. By the way, hot dogs are in the deal. All right. So when you think about what traditional hot dogs are supposed to be, they're supposed to be the scraps, all right, the skin and the ligaments and tendons and stuff like that. So that's actually the stuff that we're looking for. So hot dogs in theory would be extremely healthful. But, you know, a lot of modern grocery store standard hot dogs probably have a lot of bad ingredients in them. So what we want is something that's a decent quality. This Fork in the Road is a really, really good brand. Applegate has a couple of really good options. There's some other good one. Wellshire has some. So again, we're just looking for ingredients. And this is from some pasture raised pork and beef. So hot dogs are totally in the deal. One of our favorite foods. By the way, Arnica, we need to put that on our list this week. You have not had hot dogs. Hot dogs wrapped in bacon are amazing, y'all, especially dipped in Arnica sauce. Bacon, absolutely love. If you did a spot check, sneak check on veteran SHT people in the community right now, not just in our online community, but just in general, like the people all over Vegas and all over the states here. If you did a spot surprise check in their refrigerator and or their purse, like I guarantee you they're going to have bags of bacon in there, because it's just something that we live off of. All right. Oven bake your bacon in big packages, and then you've got bacon for a week, and it's so good tasting. You can chop it up and mix it in with other stuff, and most of us love it. Now, it doesn't matter if it's uncured or cured. That's a misnomer. I have a whole blog post on it. I would say just make sure that you get a decent quality. Ideally, you're looking for a hormone antibiotic free if possible, right? But bacon is bacon. Again, trying to make this work in a modern lifestyle, you can get it wherever floats your boat. Just make sure it doesn't have those toxic oils and stuff in it. Deli meats, totally fine. Obviously not as optimal as cooking your own roast beef or cooking your own chicken, but in a pinch and to have something as a snack or to bring with you to lunch, I think it's perfectly appropriate to have some pepperoni, salami, some deli meat, some cheeses and things like that on hand to make things super simple when you're making kids' lunches and things. We love salami. We love pepperoni. We love cured meats in general, especially traditionally cured meats like pepperoni, salami, and prosciutto. And again, we have a whole blog post on that. I think it's a podcast and a video. Seafood is awesome. I feel like a lot of us need to eat more seafood. Wild caught is going to be best, and shellfish is going to be extremely nutrient dense. You can do canned every now and then. I'll get a can of oysters. I love those Crown Prince. Wild sardines are awesome. There's a few different varieties out there. I remember my dad used to make me eat sardines from the AFI's commissary on military posts, and it was the worst quality, and it tasted horrible and made me sick. But today, man, these sardines taste great. Like they roast them, and they have olive oil, some marinara sauce or something like that, and they taste amazing. And then we've already mentioned before, we love frozen produce. We love frozen berries and frozen fruit. By the way, a really good quick dessert is to keep a bag of frozen berries inside the freezer, pour a few of them into a mason jar, pour some heavy cream with some honey in there and shake it up, and you've got some cream fruit, and it's really amazing. You could also put it in a blender and have like a little smoothie or something like that. Now, along the lines of eating animals nose to tail, I think the reason I mixed those pictures in is because that's how I move through the store. Along the lines of eating animals nose to tail, one hack that we can use in addition to eating bone in, skin on, and fatty cuts would be to consume bone stock regularly. So a lot of us are consuming like a cup to a half a quart to a quart of bone stock a day. And if you're not familiar with bone stock is basically taking animal bones, simmering them in water, and then when those bones are simmered in the water, the tendons and ligaments and cartilage and connective tissue dissolve into the liquid of the water. And so when you consume the water, you're getting all those tendons, ligaments, and connective tissue that you might not otherwise be eating, right? So a really good way to try to mimic eating an animal nose to tail, in addition to your animal foods and your fatty cuts and bone in the skin on, is to consume bone stock on a regular basis. As a general rule, I'd say like a cup to a half a quart a day is going to be optimal, okay? So there's some that you can find in the frozen section. I have a few listed here. Bonafide is a really good company. By the way, Bonafide, a classmate of mine actually started this company, and I taught her how to make freaking bone stock. And she just sold it to somebody for like millions of dollars. So, but anyway, that's in the frozen section. And then we've got Kettle and Fire and a couple of others that are in the non-perishable section. Once you open it, it becomes perishable, but these are really good options. The most cost-effective is going to be the Pacific brand there, and you can find it at a lot of different grocery stores, including sometimes Costco and Winco. And so I usually will keep some of that here in the fridge just in case I run out of my regular bone stock that we make. By the way, we have a video on store-bought bone stock options, which, man, I can't even believe it. Like, we got, like, I think it was, like, 30,000 views on that thing. Most of my videos have, like, 50 or something, or not even that. But so this is a really good video where we go through, like, what to look for, okay? And then we also have a really good video on how to make your own bone stock, and we try to break it down and keep it as simple as possible. We will, we might even do it today. Take a set of bones, put it in an Instant Pot, run it for 240 minutes, which is 4 hours, and we'll get three or four quarts of stock out of that. And then we'll use that same batch of bones and run it two or three more times, which means we're getting another three or four times another three or four. So we're walking out of that situation with like sometimes 16 quarts of stock, sometimes 10 or 12 or something like that. So very, very easy to make your own bone stock. You know exactly what's going into it. We flavor it very simple, and it's amazing. All right. And we are almost to the end here, y'all. Let's talk about sweeteners. Not a fan of agave. Agave used to be really popular in the kind of diabetic, you know, blood sugar handling realm, simply because it didn't have much of an impact on blood sugar levels. And the reason for that is because it's very high in fructose. It's also very highly processed. So we believe that the all-time number one best sweetener in the world is going to be raw, unpasteurized, ideally local, but doesn't have to be local. You can get some really good unpasteurized honeys online, Amazon. We actually buy some from Utah. But what you're looking for is raw, unfiltered, unpasteurized, right? It's a superfood. A lot of traditional cultures these days still consume honey as one of their favorite foods. Many had brought up in the community, what about maple syrup? Because they have moved away from labeling it as grade B or grade A, and now it's either dark or light. Maple syrup, totally fine. Ideally, you're going for the darker version. Supposedly, it has some more nutrients. I think it's not that significant. We love the flavor of coconut sugar. Coconut sugar is going to have a little bit more nutrients in it. It's got kind of like a toasted brown sugar taste to it. We use it for sweetening some of the rare treats that we make, like our SHT fudge, our shit patties and stuff. Cane sugar is fine if you need it for something, but I would say maybe try to use honey or coconut sugar for any recipe that requires sugar, but you could use some organic cane sugar if you needed to. And then things like stevia and flavored stevias are going to be perfectly fine. Just read the ingredients. Most of them have checked out as far as I could see. I like the brand Sweet Leaf. Another really popular sweetener out there that is a almost a zero, I think it is a zero calorie. Yeah, zero calorie sweetener is this monk fruit Lancanto sweetener. It's got monk fruit extract and then erythritol in it, which is a sugar alcohol. It's equal parts for sugar. So if you have a recipe that calls for a cup of sugar, you can use a cup of Lancanto here, and it's going to be no sugar added for the most part. Now, to finish this little talk here, keeping things brutally simple, 90% of the stuff that we cook uses these seasonings right here, because we're cooking ground beef, we're cooking steak, we're cooking pork chops, we're cooking chicken, and 90% of the time, we put butter in a skillet and we season these meats and vegetables and things with salt, pepper, and garlic powder. And when you get garlic powder, I would not get the garlic salt because you're using your own salt. I would use granulated garlic or just garlic powder. By the way, if you're getting salt, I would replace your Morton salt with an unrefined salt. I love the Redmond's real salt. You can also get Himalayan or Celtic salt. But this is the majority of what we use most of the time when we do our cooking. Literally, this is it. Okay, and then, of course, we're using the other ingredients like the meats and goat cheeses and eggs and things like that, right? I also have a list here that I started that is what I'm calling a starter kit. So we've got that brutally simple list of seasonings, ghee, salad dressings, condiments of your choice, olive oil for salads, stuff for coffee. We mentioned this yesterday. It's also in your guide. If you want something creamy, you've got heavy cream as an option, coconut milk, goat milk, vanilla extract for a little bit of sweet or a little bit of a vanilla flavor. You can use some honey. You can use some stevia. All right. For snacks, you want to make sure you have on hand available at your office, in your purse, in your backpack, at home, pork rinds, meat bars, jerky, pepperoni, salami, guacamole, vegetable sticks. Make sure that you have some honey. Honey is not going to go bad on you. Coffee and tea, some white rice, some frozen produce of your choice, some bars just in case. And then if you need it, some soda replacements like Zevia, LaCroix, and then some sparkling waters. I think that's a really, really good list of stuff to start with, okay? I think that's all we got, guys. Sorry that took a little bit longer than an hour, but I do feel like that was useful. I'm going to tab over here one more time and see if we have any other questions. We got one more question. All right. So you said unpasteurized honey, but I think you said we should look for pasteurized eggs. Oh, cool. No, that's a really good question. So Natasha asks, you said unpasteurized honey. The reason I specify the unpasteurized is because of labeling laws, you can still, I'm pretty sure you can still pasteurize honey at a very low temperature and still call it raw, all right? So I usually look for a company that specifically says unpasteurized honey. Now, when it comes to eggs, there are such things as pasteurized eggs, all right? We don't want pasteurized eggs because those are pre-cooked eggs. What we want is pasture raised, all right? So it's two words, pasture and then raised. They look and sound the same, but they're not the same. Pasteurized is cooked. Pasture raised means the chicken is out in the grass, able to dig around and eat worms and bugs and grubs and whatever else they can find out there, because chickens are omnivores. And when they're able to do that, they make a much more nutritious egg, okay? Today is the first day. For those of you in this progression, I would read through that vision statement, start your week off right, do whatever shopping and food prep you need to today. Maybe think about it like this, right? Think about your week. What do you need to have on hand to have a successful first meal, all right? For most of us, it's going to be eggs and bacon or sausage, maybe a little bit of fruit, maybe some bananas or something like that, a bowl of berries, right? So get enough to last you for 5 days for the week. Also, think about what you're going to do for your evening meal. We like to use what we call the leftovers method. And every Sunday I share inside the group our leftovers method outlook for the week. And what we do is we cook enough every night for two nights. So tonight we'll cook something. I'm not sure what we're going to do, but whatever we do, we'll have leftovers for tomorrow night. So we're not cooking tomorrow night. We're just reheating. And then the next night we'll do something else. I think this week we're going to do hot dogs and bacon for our evening meal. We'll do a taco night one night. We haven't done chicken strips in a while, so chicken fingers. But regardless, you're only cooking every other night. So you're mainly cooking maybe about three nights a week. And then you have a lot of leftovers that you're eating the next night. And then sometimes at the end of the week, you have what we call a leftover smorgasbord, where you have leftovers from every night of the week. And then you just have this variety of stuff. It's so good. So I think that's a good way to strategize your week. If you have any questions, comments, feedback, send it my way. Use the community. Love you guys. Keep it real. All right.